technically but, already.
I have learned that if I can fit things in nooks and crannies, if I can
something that bothers me, just taking a second and praying, saying, Lord, I need help with this. You know, there's so many things that we can do, even as busy people, that will allow His presence to be there, a part of our lives. And I think with David, knowing how hard he worked and how alone it was, I can only see benefit from it. And I'm not opposed to thinking I need the same. So I encourage you to think about, how do you get to know God better? How do you get more presence in your life? Exactly what David did. It's not a secret. And the Lord will meet you. Okay. So, because David knew God was for him and not against him, he then made the statement, I will fear no evil. That's a powerful statement. I will fear no evil. Remember how we talked last time, how I had said I couldn't for a while say God, because I was just so angry and hurt by what He allowed in my life. And it's the idea that I had this perspective, this belief about God, that He really didn't care. He really wasn't going to be nice to me. And I really want to bring that out, because when we truly know God, when we know His character, when we know His passion for pursuing us, when we know His mercy, His grace, when we learn about what it is that He wants to do in our life, when He has a plan and a future, a hope, then we begin to realize that those things are skewed. Those beliefs are skewed, not because it didn't hurt, but because we wanted God in a box, and He isn't going to fit in a box. So David then says, I will fear no evil. I know His character, His care, and His mercy. I hope that we can begin to learn to pray that as well. Even though I walk through the valley, I will fear no evil. It's been a little bit of a rough week. I know this week I received news of a friend of our church going into hospice. If you or any of you know Bobby Collins, she was admitted into hospice this week. So just pray for her and her family. There's Familial Master is also, she's experienced the death of her husband recently, and she's having a celebration of life this weekend. Another person that I was talking to had gone in for a follow-up mammogram, and today found out the good news that it was just a clogged duct of debris. So there is no cancer. Like, there are so many things. There's just, roller coaster this week already that have driven me to the Lord going, I don't want to fear an evil or help my unbelief. Because it can be really easy to get caught up in fear and anxiety. I have to think that the way David did it was to keep his focus on God. That it wasn't the circumstances that held his attention. It was that he was thinking about God and his pursuits, his victories that he had shown, the things that David had experienced of his favor. And that, I think, is how he can fear no evil. Not only does he understand the power of God, he also understands the depth of relationship that God was looking for. I thought this was kind of funny in the book. It says, I can walk through the valley. It doesn't say you die there or stop there. Rather, you go through. That's a good thing for us to remember. Second thing that I thought was really cool is it said, the valleys we walk through can take us to a higher ground. I've got to go through valleys to get to the higher ground. I think that that's something that we don't like because it doesn't make us comfortable. We like being able to be on the mountaintop and not go through the other stuff. misgivings give way to calm and quiet confidence in his care. Somehow, in a serene, quiet way, he has assured me that all will turn out well for my best, because he is with me in the valley and things are under his control.
If you're like me, this can become very rote again.
God got this.
Well, sometimes, you know, I need a little bit more than just God guides. I need God to speak peace to my heart. I need him to take that fear and drive it away.
And I think part of how that happens is when, again, we look at him instead of our situation. And trust that whatever we're going through, God can use it for good.
It was interesting this week when Matt and I were talking. I was saying to him how I never wanted him to get sick, but I have so appreciated the chance to share what's been in my heart. And he said, you know, I wouldn't have chosen to get sick either, but I really liked the mental reset that it gave me, the opportunity to just focus on being at rest and not having to drive myself and think about a ton of things. And he liked the 20 pounds he lost too. So, I mean, even though things were tough for a couple of weeks, it doesn't mean God isn't still using it in ways that bless and honor others. So we want to make sure that we're thinking about those things. As Christians, we will sooner or later discover that it's in the valley of our lives we find refreshment from God himself. It's not until we have walked with him through some very deep troubles that we discover he can lead us to find refreshment in him, right there, even in the midst of our difficulty. Let come what may, Mr. Keller writes. Storms may break around me, predators may attack, the rivers of reverses may threaten to inundate me, but because he is in the situation with me, I will not fear. So, the last part of that specific verse is, it's not a question of the number of valleys. Are you guilty of saying, how much more, God? How much do I have to go through? It's not the question of the number of valleys. It's whatever number it takes to get me to that higher ground, because that is his purpose. That is his goal. His desire is to see us on that higher ground. Yes?
Yes.
Yeah. Y'all are quiet. Anybody? Comments before we go to the next part?
Well, the valleys must be the downsides where you're in bad shape, and then the higher ground is when God lifts you out of it.
Yep, I would agree. When you overcome the circumstances.
The valleys are where you grow.
The valley is
and then the mountain is where the Lord soothes you and gives you rest and peace. You know, that's the way I always looked at it.
Well, David's saying that he received some soothing in the midst of the, you know, all of the torment of the hardships of the shepherds.
Well, I think of Christ sleeping in the ship when the storm was about, and everybody was like, well, hey, wake up, buddy, you know?
Yeah, that's good.
And he's like, be still.
Be still, that's right. Yes, and that's where I'm going to get to be. You know?
Me too.
Me too.
Aren't shaken by the circumstances. We're there and we know that God is for us and will take care of whatever need we have.
True.
Mm-hmm. Cool. Well, we're going to go ahead and move to your rod and your staff. They comfort me. Okay. So, according to Keller, he taught us, if you read it, if not, well, you're welcome to read it when you have time. Sheepmen usually only carry a few things. They carried rifles, and that day they carried staffs. They may have a small bag with a few first aid remedies, a bottle of water, and possibly food. They travel light. I think a lot of us like our comforts, and that's something that can kind of hamper us if we were carrying around a big backpack with a sleeping bag and a tent and all that kind of stuff. It can be a little more difficult to travel. But they just travel very lightly. So, the rod. That's what the sheepmen relied upon to safeguard themselves and their sheep. It was also the instrument that he used to discipline and correct any wayward sheep that is There are three areas of sheep management, this is just more information, where the staff is used. Again, I didn't know this. That it's used to gently lift the newborn to its mother should they become separated. That crook part, that hook, is what they use that for, because the scent of the shepherd's hand could cause the ewe to be ejected by its mother.
Oh, wow.
I did not know. I thought, wow. I knew that about birds, but I did not know that about sheep. Individual sheep are caught and brought to the shepherd for examination. You know, we talked about how he removes furs and, you know, takes care of different things. That's one of the ways that the rod is used for. It's used for guiding the sheep, you know, tapping as they go along. At times, the last one is the shepherd may use the staff to stay in touch with the sheep. In other words, they hold it to the side, which is an extreme comfort to the sheep. I thought that was really cool, too. I never didn't realize that that was one of the things they used a staff for, was that they would keep in contact with the side of the sheep, and that that brought the sheep a lot of comfort. And obviously, I equate that to myself when I'm spending time with the Lord and I'm feeling that touch. It is very comforting. So, how does this apply to us? Well, the rod is equal to the Word of God, which the Holy Spirit uses to direct, share His love, correct, and heal us with. It can be a very intimate process where the shepherd and his rod search every inch of the sheep to see the depth of well-being of that sheep. Man, I could stop right there. I can't for a long time. I mean, God is, He knows us so well that He wants to make sure that every single part of us is free. It's very much like what we talked about at the end last time, where we have a God who knows not just the hairs on our heads, He knows everything we've gone through. He knows what wounds we need to have healed. He knows what supports we need. He knows what we need someone to give us a hug, walk beside us, send us a note. He speaks to His other people, and He speaks to us. He knows us, and He wants us to know Him. And so this intimate process where He knows us so deeply is meant to draw us to Him, because it builds trust and it builds confidence. And it's a comfort that the shepherd cares enough to do this. Again, I just don't know how long it took, but I'm guessing it took quite a while to go over a sheep to make sure that it was good. Psalm 139:23-24 says a little bit about that, but just for time's sake, we're going to keep moving. In every situation, under every circumstance, there is comfort in the knowledge that God's word can meet and master the difficulty if we rely on it. Anybody want to make any comments about that?
Will you repeat it?
Sure. In every situation and under every circumstance, there is comfort in the knowledge that God's word can meet and master the difficulty if we rely on it. Kind of convicting.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I just thought I'd put it out there because I am convicted knowing that if I am anxious or, as right before this, very frustrated, He cares. And there is scripture that will restore peace, which we talked about last, when they choose to rest, when they're not being bugged, things didn't go the way I thought they should or wanted them to, but that doesn't mean it's not going to be okay. And that's what God wants me to do, is to look back at His word and say, well, what does God say about it? So if there are situations that we don't know how to handle, we have that alternative. We have that step. What does God say about it? What's the word say? And then go from there. It's going to save us a lot of heartache if we choose what the word says instead of just stepping off and getting all worked up.
Just like we read here in Psalm 23, he says He is with us.
Mm-hmm.
In Exodus, He promises that He will be with us. In Isaiah, He says, when you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. And when you walk through the fire, you will not be burned up. The flame will not consume you. Those are the promises you're given. You shall live forever. This is a beautiful thing. There's nothing you have to fear here. No man you have to.
Absolutely. Thank you for sharing that. I'm not trying to seem insensitive to anybody's problems. I'm really not. I'm trying to inject hope where there may not be hope. And recognize that I don't have the power, but God does. And He's willing to use that power to bring His kingdom. You know, He wants to work in our lives so that other people can see His character and see His power. And we give Him that opportunity when we trust Him in situations. Now, should we, which I think all of us have done, act rashly or stubbornly, God's Spirit will still rescue us because His grace and mercy is there. He will save us and He will bring us back to Himself. We don't have to be worried about that either. Which he was talking about the sheep at that point. I can relate, you know? I can relate. Where sometimes I'm just going to do my own thing. But it usually hurts really hard. And that helps me to learn my lesson and not go that direction again.
Well, I understand what you're saying and what he's saying, you know. I mean, but God gave us feelings to have feelings.
True.
To have the feeling of fear, to have the feeling of sorrow and mourning and stuff. Because with those feelings, that's when you find God a lot of times. So, I mean, for me, I mean, you know, it's kind of nice once in a while to have a little bit of fear because that's when you search for God or that's when His presence is found, I think. So, you know, in sorrow and mourning and everything, you know, there's reasons He wants us to feel like that a little bit once in a while. And you know, not to just walk through and just not worry about anything, think, you know, well, God's got, you know, getting that mindset. So it's kind of nice for me to know a little bit of the down so that I know the up that He can bring me to.
Sure. I understand what you're saying. And if we're going to continue, there's definitely a section where it's basically saying, don't expect a perfect life. Mm-hmm. And I agree, God can use those things to drive us back to Him. I agree, He gave us emotions. But I also know that He says, do not be anxious. And I have found that learning to trust in situations that look grim it's usually a better outcome, or at least there's more peace in the situation when I just sit back and trust. And I'm trying to figure out the solution, or I don't stay in that place of despair. What are we going to do? You know, I agree that those are part of human nature, but I do also know that God doesn't want us to stay there. He's always telling, I'm going to lift you up. You know, what is the running not be weary, walking not faint? You know, He promises us that He wants us to be more than conquerors. So I agree. I don't want to paint a picture like there's not problems, because there are, and God does use it. But at the same time, being able to testify again and again of God's faithfulness in those situations is only possible when you've seen His hand help you overcome. Mm-hmm. And I guess that's more of what I was trying to get at.
Yeah, I don't want to stay there, but it's a good testimony, too, to share with people, to let them know what God can do for you because you've experienced it.
Right, and being human and being real is very important as well. Yes, authenticity, absolutely. Anyone else? Okay. So you prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. In some of the finest sheep countries in the world, the high plateaus of the sheep country are actually referred to as mesas, the Spanish word for tables. go ahead and to make sure that things are there exactly as they need to be. The shepherd would clean out water holes, repair dams, open springs where months of debris, of trees, leaves, stones, and soil of the past season may have stopped up that water flow. I never thought of all of that. That's a lot of work. And yet he was willing to do that, to go that extra mile. And God himself is also the same exact kind of shepherd, where he would go out of his way to help us to ensure our success. It may not always be comfortable or fun, but it wasn't for him either. You know, why would we expect less? So we have a Christian parallel. We may feel that we need to try everything that comes our way just to see what it's like. As the sheep would often just, oh, that looks good over there. Oh, well, let me try here. Or what's that all about? Very curious, very unaware. So we as Christians can do the same thing. We may even know that there are some things that are deadly and destructive, and yet we decide to do them anyway. We can remember that our Master has gone before us, anticipating what danger we can encounter, the needs that we have, and that he is praying for us, that we may not succumb to that. For example, Peter. He's even praying for us on top of all of that. He is such a good, good, good shepherd. It's not always apparent what tremendous personal cost it has been for Christ to prepare this table for his own. Just as the lonely personal privation of sheepmen who prepares the summer rain for a stock entails sacrifice, so the long agony of Gethsemane, of Pilate's Hall, of Calvary, have cost our Master much. When we come to the Lord's table, and this is very powerful, when we come to the Lord's table to take part in communion, which is a feast of thanksgiving for his love and care, do we fully appreciate what it has cost him to prepare this table for us? Anybody want to make any statements about that? When we come to the Lord's table to partake of communion, which is a feast of thanksgiving for his love and care, do we fully appreciate what it has cost him to prepare this table?
I don't think we fully appreciate it.
How do we fully appreciate it? What do y'all think?
I don't know.
How can we show our appreciation, recognizing the depth and the difficulty it was for him to sacrifice? How can we show that to him when we take communion?
By trusting in him that we are not part of. Because he tells us that we won't be. It's not because of us. We won't ever. You're absolutely right. We don't accept it. We don't do enough for it. We won't. But we have to trust that he tells us we are. When we're baptized and he says, you've been baptized and brought back to life with Christ. It's his word.
True. Yeah. Right. This study has opened my eyes even more so to the powerful experience of what it is. I shared in the newsletter months ago about one time when I went up to take communion at the church my dad was serving, and I don't really remember anything we can't really do enough to ever appreciate him, showing that we appreciate him. But maybe if we really slow down, which is hard for me when I'm trying to corral all my kids and we're trying to get up for communion and there's this, that, and the other thing, but maybe slowing down and just kind of taking some deep breaths before we get up there and just thank him. Lord, you did so much so I could do this. I'm so grateful.
Just like right now, I'm gonna, I told this to Jill, I wanted to beat him up because God's fixing to take a dear friend of mine probably tomorrow because she was declared brain dead today.
Oh, wow.
And right now, I feel like I'm not loyal with his love. He's deserted me for the last 10, 12 years, or four, no, 15 years, but starting with my husband and my son and now this. Wow. Right now, I just want to ask why. If nobody here can really ask why.
Yeah. God doesn't mind us asking questions of
him. Huh?
God doesn't mind us asking questions of
him. I know, but I wish he'd hurry up and answer.
I know, I know. That's the hard part of trusting his character, is not having the answers that we want. You know, I've asked the question many times of my mom being in the car accident when I was 10. Why? Why would you let this happen? You know, I get it, partially. I don't know the depth that you've had that experience. But
it took me a couple of years after my son died before I'd even talked to God again.
Sure. I know that feeling. Yeah. And that's a good thing to come to the table with too, Anne. Be real with God. God, I'm mad at you. This hurts really bad, and I don't like it.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's okay. God wants you to come to the table and be you, and be honest with him. He's not afraid of that stuff. He is there. And we will be holding you up in prayer, and your friends, family as well. Thank you for sharing. Well, that's not always answers.
But on the communion that you're talking about, like myself, what I do is, it was hard for me to get used to the communion every Sunday, you know, because then for me it became like it was just a ritual or a routine where I just, you know, you just do it because. You know, then you just kind of have to. I have to evaluate myself, and there's times that I won't take the communion because of what I'm harboring or what I'm feeling. Mm-hmm. And I think that's one way that I can recognize what he did for me. Know that my heart's not right for what you've done for me, so I'm not going to take the communion today. So it just kind of has to kind of be a personal thing, so I'm not in that routine of it every Sunday. So when I don't take it, that's when it really bothers me, so then I can get right so that I can do it the next week or whatever.
Yeah.
So that's one thing that I kind of do for myself so I don't get the habit of just making it a routine.
You're guarding your heart and you're being real, you're recognizing it as holy.
Yeah.
And that you're coming and you want to know that you've done what God tells you to do in preparation.
Yeah.
That's absolutely recognizing, appreciating who he is. Thank you. So true. Anybody else?
Well, I've started, you know. I just told Father Matt that I thought it was wrong for us not to be doing communion the traditional way because I feel like it's a healing. That's part of our healing process of the week, you know.
Okay.
And that this little dipping thing, I just don't get anything out of it, you know. But that's on me. That's not on Father Matt. It's on me, you know, because I'm so stuck in traditions and things that I like that. I like the traditional way.
You know, we're going to get to that. There's a section on that, but we're going to get to it.
Well, I was telling my sister-in-law, and she said, and y'all drink from the same cup. I said, oh, yeah. You know, there's nothing wrong with that. In the same cup. I said, yeah, there's nothing wrong. You know, I don't know anyone who's gotten sick from drinking from it or anything else, you know. It's not like we're chugging lugging, you know?
Yes.
Yeah.
Fruits of the
Spirit.
Yep.
Yeah. Fruits of the Spirit. Because as we are allowing God's presence to be on us and with Him, we're seeking Him, then He can bring that kind of fruit to pass in our lives. And He knows it's a journey. We're all on the journey. You know, the whole social media thing where everything's perfect on there? No, it's not true. It's not true at all. Everybody has problems. Everybody's life is messy. Everybody has things they have to overcome. And it's just by God's grace and His presence that we can. Some of us are a little bit more voluble saying that, and other of us just a little bit more quietly. Either way, that's how we overcome. So there's a second problem, actually, this is new to me too, that you know how they talked about a blemish-free lamb in the New Testament? They have to bring that in the Old Testament too, but there's something called scabs, and it's some type of bacteria, I guess, that the sheep, they love, and I didn't know this either, they love to rub their heads together. It's like this affection thing that they do. They absolutely love it. They're very friendly, and because of that, the scabs bacteria can proliferate. And unfortunately, it can cause a lot of contamination, which obviously leads to illness and bad things. So the way that the shepherd actually addresses it is by completely immersing them in a solution of olive oil, sulfur, and spices, giving them
55-gallon drum, put all the oil from the tractors and things in it, and dip our dogs, dunk them all the way under, and then let them out because it kept the fleas and the ticks out of their ears and everything. You know, otherwise you'd have to hold them down and pluck that stuff out. And they're going to have that.
Yeah. Wow. Oh, I learned something else new today.
I don't think you can do it anymore.
No, they have a lot of other options. So we can, he paralleled it with Christians. We can become contaminated from scabs by not watching what we put into our hearts and minds, as well. Remember Philippians 4:8 last week? I mentioned that. Whatever's good and pure and holy and lovely, it's not just a Bible verse. It's actually something that we are to live by because God says that's what He wants us to do, and He knows that's going to benefit us the most. So we need to make sure that we don't allow untruth, unforgiveness, bitterness to influence our thinking, because that's a lot like the scabs. And unfortunately, it can hurt a lot of other people too. It's not just us. That bitterness and that anger so to forestall and present, and to prevent this sort of thing from happening among His people, the Lord our Shepherd loves to apply the precious ointment of His presence and of His gracious Holy Spirit to our lives. So there's a quote I want to read. If He is the one who has all knowledge and wisdom and understanding of my affairs, and management of them, if He is able to cope with every situation, good or bad, that I encounter, then surely I should be satisfied with His care. In a wonderful way, my cup, or my lot in life, is a happy one that overflows with benefits of all sorts. Kind of gets into the idea of my cup overflows. A lot of us walk around going, I'm surviving. I'll make it. And yet, God, who has gone before us, God who holds us, God who takes care of us, is saying, I want to give you so much that it's overflowing, that you can share it with others, that it spills out, that it's so evident. And a lot of us may not realize that that's what He wants for us. And if we do, maybe we just need to be reminded. Who else wants to share something? If anything, if not, we can move forward. Although this next part would be. Okay. Surely goodness and I guess mercy or love is what people are familiar with, will follow me all the days of my life. Now I learned, just like I found out about this book in seminary, I learned that the word actually here is chase. Will run after, pursue. And so it's surely goodness and love will pursue me all the days of my life. The actual word can be translated into that. I really think it's powerful to realize that God is just so wanting to bring us into that place of contentment, to bring us into this fold and to take care of us and to be there for us. And He's saying, you know, my goodness and my love, it's going to pursue you. It's not, I'm never going to stop. It's just going to keep coming after you. And we want to make sure that we are where we can receive it. So, I want to throw that out there because it really helps to enlarge the perspective.
Yeah, this portion of this verse really does the same for me. In that, you know, the first part, surely or only, you know, It is only goodness will pursue us. Although we don't perceive this as only, so we want to say surely, and mercy or steadfast love, it doesn't always seem merciful, but we are promised that it is God's steadfast love that will endure forever. So I love this section, and I know exactly I hear exactly what you're saying.
Very cool. Yeah. Again, we can go back to what we've already discussed in regards to the valleys and the tables. this doesn't seem like it necessarily is going to be for our good, but it always is.
Amen.
It's always for our benefit. It's always for the advancement of the kingdom of God. And it's not easy to go through, which is why we need to embrace that nice shepherd all along. Because it isn't easy, but we know that he is for us. So it's so good to know that everything he does is good and loving, is merciful and caring. Yes, there's justice in there, and we recognize that, but the reality is that he knows what will win our hearts, and he is always trying to bring us back to him. And the people that we care about when we pray, he's doing it for them too. It is so his will to have us sit at his feet and just say, God, move, I'm here. I want to see it. I want to see you work. I want you to change the world. And I want to be watching and listening and sharing with others what it is that I've seen. It's what the disciples did too. That's not hard in the sense that we just are there. Phyllis, I was talking with her, Phyllis Byron, for those of you who know her. I was talking with her for a brief moment this morning, and I said to her, you know, I so miss you. And she said, she was just being blunt, honest with me. She goes, I'm just not sure why God still has me here. And I said, he has you here because you pray. You are a prayer, and I love that you talk to God about everything. And I am so grateful for your example. And when I got home, Matt said, yeah, she's like who you want to be when you grow up, isn't it? And I said, yeah! Absolutely!
That's cool.
Yes, she is an example of God's love at work, living, breathing person. She's so kind. And her words to me was, when I told God I didn't know why I was so here, he just said, be still. And that spoke volumes. Be still. You don't have to figure out, you don't have to know, but you're here for a reason. There's purpose in it. And God's plan is better for us than anything we could think of. I know it's hard to believe with some of the tragedies and the difficulties that we've gone through, but he is using it for our good and for others' good. And I just pray that we get that deep in our hearts so that we can know him better and love him better. Because as we sort of touched on already, the more time we spend with somebody, the more we recognize their character and who they are, the more trustworthy they become to us. And that trust is built by spending time. That trust is built by walking out on that ledge when you don't necessarily see the next step. But that's the way God does it, because he loves us to authentically and real, like a child, say, okay. Now that's actually what our newsletter is going to be about this next month, and I've already started writing about it. And the first thing that popped in my head was trust like a child. That's trust is the thing. Trust like a child. And I have so many years of experience and so many faces I've seen of my kids and other kids just looking up. Actually, it was Candace's little Esley this past week. She came. Josh was coming out of the sound booth to come out for communion with her family. And she just saw Daddy and she goes, Daddy! Like she just lit up. And I was like, oh, that's so beautiful. You know, not just that she wanted her daddy, but she was so delighted. In seeing, even though Daddy had been behind her 3 feet the whole time, you know, she was so delighted. And I thought, that's that trust that these children just love so generously. And yet God loves even more generously than that. And he's saying that his goodness, his love will pursue us so generously all the days of our lives. He, the grace and the goodness and mercy, the treatment we will receive every time from the Master's loving hands. I am thinking that Danielle may not grab all of my notes. So, I just realized there was something else. But, so, we have to come in agreement, I hope we come in agreement, with David, who says, as an explanation, implicit confidence So goodness and mercy should also follow me all the days of my life. So here's an interesting fact. Sheep readily eat lots of weeds that could quickly destroy grasslands. Their manure is the best for cultivation because of all the rich nutrients that grass that they imbibe carries. Their eating habits can turn around ravaged places, leaving those places blessed.
Wow.
David writes this. So goodness and love will follow me on the days of my life. They're also to follow us. Sir Alfred Tennyson says, the good men do lives after them. I'm going to say it again because that's kind of hard to catch. Good men do lives after them. It's a legacy. It's a blessing. God wants our lives to be lived in such a way that we have ripple effects of blessings. Matt's grandfather, he was a wonderful man. I didn't get to meet him until about 2 years before he passed. But he had, as Matt has mentioned, a school named after him and a community building. He was a godly man who loved his family and had enormous influence in the community, well respected. And I look at that as an example that God wants that for us. He wants us to have a legacy that we leave behind and not just survival. He wants us to truly be a blessing to the people that have our lives have touched, that the other people that may have touched their lives as well. So it's something to keep in mind. Now, maybe there are some things that you've done that you were like, man, I wish I could go back and do that. We're not talking about changing the past. We're talking about let's live in the future. What can we do from here on out to experience God's love and mercy and to leave that wonderful legacy to others? This is a quote out of the book, and I thought this was powerful to end this book. The only real practical measure of my appreciation for the goodness and mercy of God to me is the extent to which I am, in turn, prepared to sow goodness and mercy to others. So do unto others, that idea of showing God my appreciation when I separate the sin from the sinner and still love the person the way God made them. Very good. Well, we have, it's 8 o'clock, I just need a few more minutes, I promise. I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. The first thing he says in this book is, this sheep is content. He doesn't want anything to change ever. And then he writes, neither does the shepherd. I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Do we as Christians boast to others of the goodness of our God? Are we sharing what he brought us through? Do we show our contentment and serenity? What a distinctive